Space news, updates, James Webb, winter on Mars, Martian quakes, and more. Welcome to the 15th review of Space and Astronomy News, selected for you by the Insane Curiosity Channel. The news will try to provide a quick overview of everything interesting that has happened in recent days in the field of astronomical research and space exploration. Keep watching. Number 6. How much snow falls every winter on Mars? Have you ever wondered how much snow could accumulate on the polar ice caps of Mars during the winter season? Like Earth, Mars experiences climatic variations during its year, 687 Earth days long, because of the obliquity of its rotational axis. This leads to the summer sublimation and winter deposition of the carbon dioxide snow, which results in the formation of the seasonal polar caps. Similarly, these temperature variations result in an interaction between the atmosphere and the polar ice caps, which has a seasonal effect on surface features. On Mars, however, things work a little differently. In addition to water ice, a significant percentage of the Martian polar ice caps are in fact made up of frozen carbon dioxide, dry ice. Recently, an international team of scientists used data from NASA's Mars Global Surveyor mission to measure how the planet's polar ice caps grow and recede annually. Their results could provide new insights into how the Martian climate varies due to seasonal change. What we know about the Martian polar ice caps indicates that they are composed of three parts. First, there is the permanent ice cap, which consists of sheets of water ice several meters. Beneath that are the polar layer deposits, which are 2 to 3 kilometers thick and composed of water ice and dust. On top is the seasonal ice cap, a layer of frozen carbon dioxide deposited on top of the permanent ice caps every winter. For the sake of their study, scientists focused on the seasonal ice caps to reveal how they are affected by variations in seasonal temperatures and solar radiation, and how this is associated with annual variations in Mars's climate. Over the past two decades, measurements of the polar ice caps have been conducted using various methods: gravity variation, neutron and gamma ray flux, and modeled based on general circulation and energy balance models. From this, the team derived a series of measurements in a test region of the South Polar Ice Sheet, finding that on average the height of the accumulation layer was about 2 meters. Not a bad value, considering that the measure far exceeds the height of the snow that usually falls in any mountain location of Earth. These measurements will allow planetary scientists to learn a great deal more about the Martian climate and the annual changes it goes through. They will also help prepare future robotic and human exploration missions to the Red Planet, which are still anticipated for some time in the next decade. Number 5. Lander InSight records violent Martian quakes. InSight, short for Interior Exploration Using Seismic Investigations, Geodesy and Heat Transport, is a Mars lander designed to give the Red Planet its first thorough checkup since it formed 4.5 billion years ago. It is the first outer space robotic explorer to study in depth the inner space of Mars, its crust, mantle, and core. Well, on September 18th, InSight lander celebrated its 1,000th Martian day, or SOL, by measuring one of the biggest, longest-lasting Mars quakes the mission has ever detected. The trembler is estimated to be a magnitude 4.2 and shook for nearly an hour and a half. This is the third major quake InSight has detected in a month. On August 25th, the mission's seismometer detected two quakes of magnitudes 4.2 and 4.1. For comparison, a magnitude 4.2 quake has 5 times the energy of the mission's previous record holder, a magnitude 3.7 quake detected in 2019. The mission studies seismic waves to learn more about Mars's interior. The waves change as they travel through a planet's crust, mantle, and core, providing scientists a way to peer deep below the surface. What they learn can shed light on how all rocky worlds form, including Earth and its moon. While the September 18th quake is still being studied, scientists already know more about the August 25th quakes. The magnitude 4.2 event occurred about 8,600 kilometers from InSight, landed in Elysium Planitia on November 26, 2018. the most distant Templar the lander has detected so far. Scientists are working to pinpoint the source and which direction the seismic waves traveled, but they know the shaking occurred too far to have originated where InSight has detected almost all of its previous large quakes. Cerberus Fossae, a region roughly 1,600 kilometers away where lava may have flowed within the last few million years. One especially intriguing possibility is Valles Marineris, the epically long canyon system that scars the Martian equator. The approximate center of that canyon system is 9,700 kilometers from InSight. That's good news for seismologists. Recording different quakes from a range of distances and with different kinds of seismic waves provides more information about a planet's inner structure. This summer, the mission scientists used previous Mars quake data to detail the depth and thickness of the planet's crust and mantle, plus the size of its molten core. Mars does not appear to have tectonic plates like the Earth, but other things can shake the ground, such as fractures caused by contraction due to cooling, magma movement, and increased pressure in the depths of the subsoil, or even the impact of a meteorite. Number 4. China's first space station crew is back from orbit. There is always very little talk about space companies that are not American or otherwise non-Western, and this is not good. In particular, Chinese space activity is making extraordinary progress, and underestimating it could be unwise. On Friday, September 17th, for example, three Chinese astronauts returned safely from space following a three-month stay aboard the new Tiangong space station, and successfully landed in their Shenzhou 12 capsule at the Dongfeng landing site, located in the Gobi Desert. This was the first manned Chinese mission in 5 years, and also the longest ever since the 33-day record was so far held by the 2016 Shenzhou 11 mission, while the Tiangong crew, launched on June 17, 2016, has spent a total of 92 days on the station. This was the first of four manned missions planned for the station during the construction period, which is expected to be completed in 2022. The Chinese space station currently consists of the Tianhe core module, Harmony of the Heavens, which will be augmented with the addition of the laboratory cabin modules, which are scheduled to launch during the summer of 2022. Once these are integrated, China hopes to conduct a full range of scientific experiments and research in orbit. These activities are meant to rival those that have been conducted aboard the International Space Station, which has been in orbit for 22 years and is due to be decommissioned by 2024 at the earliest. While it is unclear if the Tiangong space station will remain in orbit that long, it is clear that China plans to maintain a space station in orbit indefinitely. Number 3. Mars helicopter Ingenuity aborted latest flight attempt because of anomaly. NASA's Mars helicopter Ingenuity didn't get off the ground as planned earlier this month. Ingenuity was scheduled to make its 14th red planet flight on September 18th, a relatively short and simple hop that would have demonstrated the little chopper's ability to fly with slightly higher rotor speeds, 2,700 revolutions per minute rather than the usual 2,537. The mission team is making this adjustment to deal with the Martian atmosphere, which is thinning out slightly as the seasons change on the floor of the red planet's Jezero crater. Ingenuity performed a high-speed rotation test on September 15th, spinning its blades at 2,800 for a spell while it remained on the ground. Everything went well, paving the way for the September 18th flight, but the chopper did not end up taking off that day. Ingenuity, in short, detected an anomaly in two of the small flight control servo motors during its automatic pre-flight checkout and did exactly what it was supposed to do. It canceled the flight. A minor problem that will be resolved immediately, but orbital dynamics will keep Ingenuity grounded for a couple more weeks at the least. Mars is now in solar conjunction, meaning it's on the other side of the Sun from Earth. Our star can corrupt and otherwise interfere with communications sent between the two planets, so NASA has stopped sending commands to Ingenuity and its other red planet robots, including Ingenuity's much larger partner, the Perseverance rover, until mid-October, when Mars will come more clearly into view. Number 2. James Webb Space Telescope, controversy over name, change it, he was a homophobe. NASA, no reason to change it. Not even space escapes the iconoclasm of the 21st century. On December 18th, NASA will send the James Webb Space Telescope into orbit, crowning more than 20 years of work and planning. The name chosen pays homage to NASA's second president, James Webb, directed the agency from 1961 to 1968, during the very years of the Apollo mission. His work was instrumental in the first moon landing, which occurred a year after his term ended. But bothering some is Webb's political past, who was undersecretary during Harry Truman's presidency. The Truman presidency argues a petition signed by 1,000 people was responsible for a campaign of persecution against LGBT people dubbed by the press Lavender Scare, conducted parallel to the more notorious season of McCarthyism in an anti-communist function. Policies of discrimination against the gay community, Webb's critics argue, would also have been carried out by NASA in the 1960s. Well, in the last few days, NASA's answer has arrived, and it has hastily dismissed the controversy, claiming to have found no evidence to justify a name change. Finally, a bit of common sense. Meanwhile, in spite of the controversy, James Webb seems to be ready for space. We will have a launch date, although it has been postponed several times in the last year, and is currently traveling to the site from which it will be launched in Kourou, French Guiana. Number 1. Hey, there's a lot of traffic around the Earth. Maybe a little too much. Earth's orbit is teeming with artificial satellites. Their number is constantly growing, and since the Soviet Union launched Sputnik, the first man-made satellite in 1957, mankind has steadily put more and more objects into orbit year after year until it reached the numbers of now, roughly 8,000 satellites. Such growth has occurred only recently, since in 2010, around our planet, there were only about 60 to 100 satellites. 2020, for example, brought about 1,300 satellites into orbit, and this will increase exponentially. As of September 16th, about 1,400 new satellites have already started circling the Earth. 94% of those launched in 2020 were small satellites weighing less than 600 kilograms. Most of these are used for observation of our planet or for communications and the internet. SpaceX's Starlink and OneWeb, for example, together launched nearly 1,000 small satellites in 2020 alone. More and more people are confusing Starlink satellites for UFOs. The problem is that they each plan to launch more than 40,000 satellites over the next few years to create what are called mega constellations. As low Earth orbit becomes crowded, concern about space debris increases, as does a real possibility of collisions and worrying astronomers about future observations. What is needed, in essence, are laws for the democratization of space, or, if that is not feasible, regulations to keep Earth orbit from becoming crowded. Amazon, for example, is creating a system to deorbit its satellites within 355 days of mission completion. But low Earth orbit is becoming increasingly crowded with humans, too. In September, as many as 14 people were in orbit at the same time, aboard three different spacecraft. This is a new record that will no doubt be broken again in the future. Who are these people? The crew of SpaceX's Inspiration 4 mission, where four private citizens were enjoying a three-day stay around the Earth, seven astronauts on the International Space Station, and finally the three astronauts on China's space station. We will see more and more similar situations in the future, thanks mainly to the growing popularity of space tourism. The previous record was 13 astronauts, equaled on several occasions, in 1995 when the space shuttle Endeavour hosted seven astronauts and the Russian Mir station hosted six, and in 2009 when the International Space Station hosted 13 astronauts. It took 12 years to break the record, but we're willing to bet that the next record will be achieved in less than a year. Okay guys, we're done for the week. What do you think? What news struck you the most?